What's that?
Nope.
Trent says he has it.
Thanks for coming out. Welcome.
There might be a battery. There's a 9-volt in there. Okay. We'll do the first song with this guitar.
I was like,
someone wants to bring up a battery.
Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before you, open to the sun above. On the clouds I've seen in sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of fill us with the light of day.
Say hi to someone this morning and welcome them to church this morning, and we'll call up the pastor, Carter.
Morning. How are you?
How are you? Fine.
Good. I'm Carter.
I'm Aiden Brubaker.
What's your name, sorry?
Brubaker, Aiden.
Aiden Brubaker. Good to meet you. Good morning. Good morning, everyone. It's an awesome day. Could I invite the fellas up, actually? Welcome. If you are visiting here, we want to make sure you feel welcome. Stick around afterwards. We actually have a corn roast today. So if you like corn, which I'm pretty sure everybody does, stick around for the cornrows and hang out and get to know someone. And we hope that you connect here today, and also that you obviously enjoy worshiping God together with us today. These are the Fells. This family is an awesome, awesome family, and they have some exciting news to share with us today. So this is Aaron and Amanda and their family, and I'll just hand this over to them for them to share. What has God been doing in your guys' life?
Well, I guess everything that's been happening lately is a result of what happened a year ago. A year ago, God called me back to school to pursue becoming a pastor. Through a lot of wrestling and prayer, we decided that that's what God wanted. So I went to EBC for part-time for two semesters, where I felt like God was saying, pursue youth ministry. Didn't know what it looked like. So January, I had done a co-op at Youth for Christ in Listowel, and just really felt like God was saying, this is where you need to be. So I talked to Kevin, we prayed every week about it, and just really felt like God was saying, this is where you're supposed to be. So I applied at Youth for Christ in Minto, which is, covers Palmerston, Harrison, and Clifford, because there's a huge need there. So we then we felt like God was saying, I want you to move there to be in the community. So we actually purchased a house a week or 2 weeks before I had the job interview. Not the normal sequence that you do things, but it was something we very strongly felt like God was saying, this is what I want you to do. So we got the house, then had the interview, and got accepted at YFC Minto.
Awesome. Yeah. Yeah, so Jesus has been this family's lighthouse, and they've been following him, and he has been leading them. And this results in some needed change. So what does that actually look for you guys? Like, is this going to be hard? Is this going to be...
It will be hard. It will be a struggle. Because we will be going down to one income for who knows how long. The kids will have to transition schools. We will be leaving LEMC and looking into a church in Harrison so that we can be in the community even more. Once I have all my fundraising done and I start working there, I will be going down even more part-time at the place that I currently work. So it'll be a balance between work and family and ministry, and then helping the kids through their transition into a new school.
What are you guys excited for with this change?
I think the biggest thing for me is just I'm excited to see how God's gonna use us. Because I really feel like we stepped out in faith and we have no idea what it's gonna look like. So the biggest thing for me is just seeing how God's gonna move. I'm excited to see him move in ways that I've never seen before. Just excited to see youth come to Christ, see youth that are currently in a relationship with Christ make it their own, not take on the faith of their parents, but start questioning and wrestling and coming to love Jesus their own way and serve him how they're called to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what kind of challenges do you expect to face that we could support you for and that you'll be wanting prayer for, God's help for?
Well, like I said, we will be going down to One Income, so praying and trusting that God will provide all our monetary needs. Praying and trusting that God will bring along partners to come alongside me and in ministry, both prayerfully and financially. Just praying for spiritual protection for us as a family, as we continue to venture deeper and further into ministry, and prayer for whatever it is that God's calling Amanda to do as we move there.
Awesome. So this is a family, again, that is just like the rest of us here, and they're just taking a new step, and they are an amazing family. Aaron, it was a privilege to have Aaron serve in junior youth this past year, and he did an awesome job, and it's so cool to see that he is then, you know, stepping into this real youth leadership role in a new town, and a big step for them, but just another step along a series of trusting God for them as a family. We're going to invite the prayer team to come up. We're just going to pray for this family. The whole family needs prayer. It's going to need God's help through this whole process. And so, Aaron, maybe you can just pass the mic to whoever will.
One last thing. So we do move Saturday, this Saturday. Yes. So this will likely be our last Sunday here at LEMC. We will probably be back and forth in and out throughout life, but we just want to pursue God in Harrison, pursue being a part of the community. Mm-hmm. So.
You're close by.
Cool. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much for the Fells, God, and we just thank you first and foremost for their obedience to seeking out your voice and then obediently following what you're calling them to. And so, Father, we're just so excited for the opportunity that you're giving them. And, Father, I just pray that any fears or worries are just gone in your name because, God, you are a God of love, and so you take that away. And, Father, I just also ask that as they move, God, you will just raise up an army of people to come alongside them in Harrison, in Clifford, in Palmerston, to walk alongside them in their ministry as they just pour into the lives of youth there. And so, Father, we're just so excited for what you're going to do through them and to hear the stories of what you're doing there for them.
Father God, I thank you for people who are obedient to your call, who hear your voice and listen and obey. And God, I just thank you for Aaron and Amanda, and I just pray for them now as we send them out. Lord, just I'm so thrilled that this church is a church that sends people out. And so we send them with our blessing, and we send them with our prayers. And Lord, we know that your heart is for the lost. Your heart is for young people. And so, God, you have given them the same heart, the same desire. And, Lord, I pray that that desire would just continue to burn inside them. And, Father, I thank you for their whole family. May you provide every need. May they never be in want. But, Lord, that they would trust you in everything, in Jesus' name.
Father, I just pray that you meet their hearts' every desire, Father, just their desire to follow you. And we just pray deep protection over their marriage and over their kids and their relationships. And we pray for deep connections in their new community, Father, as we send them from here, that they just feel our continued connection and support from a family, a church family that just loves them so much, Father, but then that you have connections ready for them there, that they will just feel welcomed into that community, and that they will have the ability to welcome others into that community. And we just look forward to stories and testimonies of how you are using them. And so we just pray your deepest blessing and protection over them in Jesus' name.
Father, I pray over this family. Lord, I know firsthand where they are headed
and what they are coming into. I pray protection over them, Lord. I pray for the work that they will be doing, that you will guide them and be with them every step of the way. Lord, that you would bring partners alongside them. Lord, that we as a church would not forget to pray for them and lift them up. Lord, I know this area. I live here. I live there. And it is not always an easy community to be part of. And I just pray that you would bring them all the encouragement that they need every step of the way. Lord, that you would bring them into the right church that would support them in what they are doing. Lord, that you would bring them inspiration along the way as they are really pretty much beginning a new work in this area, in this community. I thank you mightily for their willingness to step out in faith in doing this, Lord. And I just pray your abundant blessing upon them. Mm-hmm. I pray that the transition into a new community goes smoothly and easily, that the transition for the kids into a new school, that they would just have friends right away and just fit in and just feel like home right away, Lord. And I pray this all in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Awesome. Thank you.
Let's just give the Fells a hand and just celebrate this. Again, thank you for praying for them this morning, and we really encourage you to continue praying for this family, and congratulate them today, as you see them, as this is their, again, their last Sunday regularly attending here. They're seeking to get connected to a church where they're headed, so that's just awesome. This is a church that, again, we believe in prayer because we absolutely need God's help with life. We need him to move. We need him to answer our prayers and to meet our needs. And so Kendra will just share an update on other prayer things that have been going on here.
It's kind of fun how God can just put something on your heart and then he affirms it through someone else. Some of you may have heard the story about how we've been prayer walking all over Listowel. And we've tried to get people involved from every church in Listowel, and it's just been a neat opportunity for unity and to just cover our town in prayer, because God works when we pray. And instead of living in a spirit of fear over things that are happening in our world and all these things going on, we get to stand in this place of safety and security in God. And so we have been working on praying for Listowel. There is a blog, Listowel Prayer Initiative, and there has been a map, I don't know if it worked out to get it over there, that we have been highlighting every street that has been prayed for in red, because we want to be really intentional not to miss a single street. So we have been meeting every Thursday at 7 p.m., and we are going to do that, we're going to continue doing that the next few Thursdays also, but we have multiple churches that we want to pray for yet, and schools. So we're hoping for these next two Thursdays especially to have a pretty good crew out and some people that perhaps have the ability to drive that could maybe go from one church to another church with some others to go pray over the churches, because there's something powerful when you're standing on another church's parking lot surrounding their building, and we have people from our church and from the Baptist church and the Pentecostal church and multiple other churches in town. And when you're praying for somebody else's church, there's just such power in that. And so if you are able to come out one of the next couple Thursdays, 7 p.m. this week Thursday, we will be at the Blue Box Cafe. That's where we're gonna meet, because we have some of the Wallace South area that we wanna cover yet. And then keep an eye on the blog, Listowel Prayer Initiative, because we'll post there if we're meeting at the amphitheater or not. Then today's a really special day because we're gonna meet at 3 p.m. If you have kids that can't be out on Thursday night at 7 p.m., it wrecks them or whatever. We want to do some afternoon opportunities. So today at 3 p.m. at the Listowel Amphitheater, we're gonna meet and go out from there to pray. Again, if there's some people that, if there's some people that have the ability to drive, and especially if you have friends at some other churches, gather a few of you up and we'll send you out to what churches we need some prayer for, just to really keep that unity factor. It's pretty exciting. And then, is someone announcing Unite tonight?
Go for it.
Okay. Then after that, at the amphitheater also at 6 p.m., there will be ice cream in that at the amphitheater as part of Unite Tonight, which the service will start at 7, and there will be worship there tonight, and I believe story sharing. I'm not certain on that part, but it's going to be great. And again, Unite Tonight is an opportunity to gather with believers from all over and just spend some time in worship. The amphitheater is at the Listowel Park. You kind of go like down past the pool. It's this beautiful area that we get to sit in the outdoors and worship God. So come on out to that tonight at 7 and to the prayer walk at 3, and Thursdays at 7 p.m. for the prayer walk also. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you. Often in announcements, we just hear about what's coming up, but sometimes it's really important to hear what God has already been doing and to celebrate that. Later on, actually, we'll hear from Jethro as well. But yeah, we just want to continue to seek God today. Pastor Jeff and his family are still on vacation. They're on vacation for another week, and we just want to pray for them as well, that they have a good, restful time, come back feeling refreshed. And just join me in prayer as I just pray for us all today. Father, thank you so much that you're here. Thank you so much that you know what's going on in our hearts. God, and we ask that you would touch us, Lord, meet our needs. And Father, we look to you to praise you, to worship you, to put you first in our lives. And God, we thank you so much for the things that you're doing in the Fells. Lord, the things that you're doing through people's prayers, the things that you're doing through a community like this, Lord. And we have very little to offer, Lord, except just our hearts, our obedience. And Father, we pray that you would do so, so much with that, because you have the power, Lord, to save. You have the power to change lives. And we look to you for that. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Lord, we just praise you. We thank you for being here. God, we thank you for how wonderful you are. God, may our hearts adore you, love you, and be in love with you always, Lord. You're so worthy. And Lord, there is no one like you who is worthy of our praise and our love and our following, Lord. So we look to you and we thank you and we just praise you for who you are.
High voltage. Okay. Come on, have a seat. Great. So boys and girls, do you remember the very first time you ever heard about Jesus? Don't remember the very first time? Zara, do you remember? Do you? Dakota? Who told you about Jesus for the very first time? You don't remember the first time, so maybe it's hard to know who told you then, but who told you about Jesus? Kenzie?
I don't know. My parents?
Yeah. I bet your parents did. I bet you they were the first ones as they held you in their arms and saying, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves me, right? Parents tell us about Jesus. And you guys come to church and you hear about Jesus, right? From Cheryl and me and other leaders. So someone told you about Jesus. And you are so blessed because someone told you about Jesus. Because we all need Jesus. That's how God created us. We need Jesus. He wants us to follow him. So our story today is going to be about a man named Philip who was told to go tell somebody about Jesus because that man needed to know. And God created us to also tell others about Jesus. Okay, so let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for the boys and girls here and how you desire us to follow you, Lord. Thank you that these boys and girls are learning about Jesus, that we have that opportunity to do that here. And in their homes, Lord, bless their parents, that they may always instill every day about your love for them. And just help these boys and girls to also share about Jesus to their friends and whoever they meet. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, we can go out that way, okay?
Good morning. Awesome. Yeah, so today, now it's our turn to think, to continue hearing from God and giving our hearts to God. I just have one more cool testimony that I think we need to hear. And it's from Jethro. Jethro, yeah, you can come up. Jethro is another man from our church who has been following God, and he just wants to give us an update on what he's doing in Quebec.
Hello. Hi, Kelly. I wasn't sure how I'd talk about this, but I just wanted you know my name. My name's Jethro, and for those who know me and those who don't know me, I'll just give a little bit of a background. About December, I felt that God was leading me to possibly go to Quebec, and so I said, "Okay, God, if this is of you, then you're gonna have to bring somebody from Quebec and to show me where I need to go." So within a few weeks, a person showed up in my life, and I'm like, okay, so I guess I gotta follow this man and go to Quebec. So I ended up going to Quebec left my work, left my job, and my plans were to be working at the car factory in Palmerston for the winter and then do evangelism in the summer. But God had other plans, so he said, okay, well, I want you to go to Quebec. And so I was like, okay, so I went to Quebec. and ended up with a family I never had ever met or knew. They didn't know me, and they said that I could live with them. They weren't really sure about that. So, and so so God led me to a place called Lac Simon, which is between Gatineau, which is just across from Ottawa, and Montreal. I'm just on the border between there, and it's been quite something. I was like, I wasn't sure why God wanted me to go to this place, but it ended up being quite interesting. I believe there's still lots for me to learn and see what God is planning. The family I live with is called the Wright family, and there's been a lot of jokes about that, about Mr. and Mrs. Wright, it's been a learning experience for myself for many reasons. There's for one, I've been practically on my own for about 10 years. About two of those years, I've had roommates at my place, and then to be going into a full family, which I was not quite used to, and so that was quite interesting. And also, this family does a type of ministry with cottages. They have about five cottages or so on their property, which Christians can book during the summer months, and for free of charge, and then have a however long they would like for relaxation or whatever. This ministry started, I think, before them with Barbara Wright's father, and they don't charge anything for that. So I've had it's been really interesting to be with them to see what a life of service is within that family, and also being in a very beautiful place. It's amazing in Lac Simon, Quebec. I didn't think I'd be to Ottawa as much as I have been. That's been quite interesting, and being so far in this part of this country, Ottawa seems so far. But I've been over there. Another evangelism has been kind of on my heart for quite a while, and so God has been using that as well within Lac Simon and Saint Andre, Avalon, Chenaville as well. It seems to be a concentrated place for festivals. It's a poorer region in that area, but there's so many festivals that have taken place. You probably have heard of Rockfest. There's 200,000 people show up in a small town in Montebello of 600 people. So like the place is just crazy with metal music and craziness. It's just awful. there's that festival, and that takes place one weekend, and then there's the Western Festival that takes place in St. Andre Avalon. There's a festival this weekend I think also St. Andre Avalon, and there's just been unbelievable amount of festivals. So I've been able to kind of reach out a little bit in that community. You never know what God's going to do with you, and so I want to encourage you to trust in Him. One of the verses from Proverbs chapter 3, 5 and 6, and it's, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy paths." And so I had no idea, and it's almost like Amanda and Aaron, where they, you know, God really appreciates and honors when people step out in faith. When they mentioned how they sold their house before they even had a job, and God looks at that and He smiles, and He wants faith in our lives as well. One story with kind of reaching out within Saint Andre, it was in Saint Andre Avalon, with the Western Festival. I was handing out different a short story called "The King, the Amazing Horse," and it started to rain, and I was like, okay, I wonder how things were going to go. Things weren't going really too well, but and I was like, okay, so I kind of got some shelter, And there was two people that showed up, kind of also trying to get cover from the rain. I didn't think the rain was going to last too long, but I was there with them, and I was thinking, okay, how am I going to talk to these people? So first off, I just asked them, I said, do you speak English? I don't know if I said it in French or English, but I just asked them. And so the girl knew English, so I got talking with her, and we started talking a little bit. And you're always wondering, okay, how am I going to share the gospel? How can we bring God into these people's lives? How can we make God a reality for these people? And what happened was what I consider kind of a God moment, because it ended up being there was this amazing rainbow that just showed up right in our line of sight, and we were just like, wow, that's an amazing rainbow. And she's like, yeah, it's really nice. It's pretty cool. And so I said, and all of a sudden it hit me, ask her if she knew where the first rainbow came from. So I said, okay, have you ever heard about how the first rainbow came to appear? And she said, no, I've never heard about that. And so I explained to her about, in the scriptures, about how God was displeased, and I went through all how with all the sin that took place, and I went through that, and then I brought that towards Jesus, how God provided Jesus as our Savior, that He's our promise, that if we have Him, that we will have everlasting life. And I didn't have a lot of time with this lady, but I said, would you like to know more about Him? And she looked at me and she said, yeah, I'd like to know more about Him. And so I handed her a New Testament, and she was gone. And then her and her friend left. And I was just like, how could that happen without God's intervention and just providing that promise and that symbol in the sky, which is being used today for so many evil, which it's really Satan taking God's symbol, the rainbow, and perverting it for his use to slander the name of God, and to make something beautiful from it. So it's been really neat. I think I don't know what God's gonna do in the future. Things are changing so much at the house that I live with, and the people there. A lot of people are leaving that house, and so it's going to be almost empty. It almost is going to just be me and the two parents, and so I'm not sure what God's plans are for me there, or what's going to take place in that property. But it's pretty cool to see God working, and yeah, let's go.
Awesome. Thank you.
It's important for us to hear the stories that we experience in our own lives and be able to share those things with other people, with each other. Some people have stepped out in faith in this room in ways that I have not, that you have not. And it's so valuable to hear those things and to hear their examples, their stories, and to see how we can be also walking out in similar ways. So we just want to thank you, to Jethro, to the Fells for sharing those things. And I hope that you find places to share your stories as well and to continue to hear the stories of other people in this room. We're going to continue today with our series on called Open Heart Surgery. And this is a sermon that Jesus shared to his disciples early on in his ministry, and it has some incredibly valuable things, and he's addressing our hearts. And we just want to look more into that today. And in the passage that we'll look at today, Matthew 6, 7 to 8, Jesus addresses this question: how do we pray so that God hears our prayers? Have you ever wondered that before? How do I know that my prayers are pleasing to God? How do I know that I'm praying in a way that God loves, that God desires? How do I know that God's hearing my prayers? And that's what Jesus talks about here. So if you have your Bibles with you, you can turn to Matthew 6 and verse 7 to 8. And you can also follow along, of course, on the screen. And when you pray, Jesus says, he says, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Jesus here is teaching us how to live. Okay, and he's talking about prayer here. Last week we talked, Jesus made a comparison in the earlier verses of this chapter to hypocrites. And he says, don't be like them. They don't really love me. They're just doing things for show. Don't be like them. Don't pray like them. Now he's making another comparison. He's saying, don't pray like the pagans either. Now, pagan isn't a very, you know, pleasant word. It is, who wants to be called a pagan, you know? It's not very pleasing. But Jesus is saying it here in a matter-of-fact way. He's talking about people who do not serve the Almighty Creator of the earth. He's saying, as it is the biblical view, as God says over and over again, it's not the same thing, one God to another. There's actually one God, one Almighty true God, and he is deserving of our worship, and no other God deserves that worship. And so when people are serving those other gods, that is not, they're not serving the right God. And that seems really maybe bigoted or arrogant to say in our culture. But in the view of there being one creator, one God, him not being served, you know, clearly in a logical sense, if that view is right, it is wrong to serve any other God. And that's what Jesus is talking about here. He's talking about... And that's what pagan refers to. So Jesus is not just trying to be rude. That's what he's talking about. So don't pray like the pagans. And they prayed with long prayers. Okay, they wanted to, either they were trying to explain to their gods what they were praying for, what they were asking for, and they thought they needed to, you know, really explain it for them to understand, or... they believed that their gods really wanted just extended long prayers, that the longer you pray, the better it is. Has anyone ever thought that before? The longer you pray, the better it is. Jesus says, don't pray like that. And why? And again, Jesus' reasoning here for what we do is all related to God's identity, our Father's identity and his character. He says, don't do that because your Father knows what you need before you ask him. He knows. Just like he sees the good things that we do when no one else sees, like we talked about last week. He knows what we pray, what we need, before it even comes out of our lips. Our Father is there, and he knows. He doesn't need an explanation. He doesn't need a performance of prayer before he listens. He just knows. Maybe sometimes you've tried to pray in ways that you thought would make God hear you better. Maybe you thought you needed to use certain godly words, you know, sanctify me, Lord, or I don't know, other godly words. Or maybe you thought if I just prayed, you know, 3 minutes longer, God would have heard what I said. You ever thought that before? Jesus is saying, don't be tempted to think that's the way God hears our prayers. Those petty changes, those petty things. Jesus is saying that's not what makes the difference between God hearing our prayers or not. And this is a beautiful thing. Jesus is teaching us here how to pray the way that pleases God. And he's talking about our heart. And this is what he's going to dive us into here. But this is such a valuable thing. Do we not want to pray in a way that we know pleases God? And yet Jesus here, the Son of God, is teaching us how to do that. This is an incredibly valuable, valuable thing. He says, don't perform in your prayers. That is not what matters. But Jesus says, pray like this. He says, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors, and lead us not into temptation. Sorry, we'll just head back to the first slide. We'll stay there for now. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. this is how Jesus teaches us to pray. I want you to continue looking at this prayer as we talk through this. Think about this. And what we'll see here is that God, what matters to God when we pray, is that we are trusting Him. We are trusting Him not just for our provision, but also for our direction. What matters to God when we pray, what makes Him hear, care about our prayers in an immense way, is that we are trusting Him not just for provision, to provide for us, give us what we need, what we want, but also we're trusting Him for direction. This prayer is a follower's prayer. If we're not following God, it's not a very pleasant prayer to pray. If we just want things from God, or if we're just, you know, interested in God, this prayer is not very exciting. And you'll see that as we follow, as we go through what this prayer says. Okay, Jesus says that we can address God as our Father. And He talks about God as our Father, and we saw that last week as well. But this is who our God is. He's not a distant God. He's not disinterested in us. While He made the universe, He cares about individuals, and He's actually attentive to us. This is our Father in heaven. And Jesus here is clarifying for us the relationship that we can have with our God, and it's a relationship of intimacy, a relationship of commitment, a relationship where we really matter. We are His children, and He is our Father. The best Father we could ever imagine. And in prayer, that's who we get to talk. That's how this starts. Our Father in heaven. And as Jesus continues, He shows us how we're supposed to respond to this Father of ours. He says, "Hallowed be your name," or "May your holy name be honored." That's what this means. May your holy name be honored. If you have a Bible and you've always wondered, what does that even mean, hallowed be your name? We don't really use that word anymore. But may your holy name be honored. That's what this is asking for. Jesus tells us to seek the praise and the honor of our Father. Father, in what we as your people say and do, and how we talk about you, may you receive our greatest respect, our greatest honor, our consistent worship. That's what this is saying here. Your name, everything about you, may you be treated as you are. Wonderful, perfect, greater than all other things. Here we are and we worship you. That's our attitude, Jesus says in prayer. That's the way we are to see this Father of ours. And now Jesus says, continue like this. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now here, this is not a prayer of someone who just wants to get something from God. Now, has anyone noticed that they pray more when you want something in your life? You pray more when you want something. Even people who don't believe in God pray more when they want something in life. We often do. But this is the attitude Jesus teaches us to have in our prayers, and it is the attitude of a person who surrenders to their Father's direction and wisdom. Father, do in this world everything you want. Father, do in this world everything you want. Do with us everything you want. Do with me everything you want. This is a surrender. We hold on to nothing but you. Have your way. That is what we want. We don't want our way. We want your way. Now, Burger King used to have the slogan, have it your way. Yeah? Nice slogan. Everyone wants it their way, especially their hamburger. But Jesus is telling us that our attitude in prayer, in our attitude in life, is to be different than have it our way. He's saying is to lay that down and to say, no, Father, have it your way. And then when Jesus says, your kingdom come, he's meaning God, rule over this world. God, you are our king. We want you to have everything that you want here. We hold on to nothing. Have your way. Make this everything that you want, everything that pleases you. Make earth just like heaven, a place where you are honored, you are loved, you are followed 100%, a place that reflects your goodness and holiness. Jesus teaches us to approach our Father and ask not just for what we want, but for what our Father wants first and foremost. Now, this is not just the way that Jesus teaches us to pray, but this is actually the way, as we read through the Gospels, as we read through the Bible, this is the way that Jesus lived towards his Father. When he was in the garden and he was about to be betrayed, and he was about to be arrested and beaten and killed, Jesus knew what was coming, and yet, in the garden, he prayed, "Father, I don't want this responsibility, but not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, but yours be done." And Jesus, he prayed this three times, and he was stressed out. But he opened up his heart to God, and he obediently followed his Father's desires, which led to his death on the cross, which is what brought us life. It was Jesus' submission to the Father's will that gave us life. And that is how we are to pray as well, in submission to his will. Now, what kind of person can pray that kind of prayer? Again, I want us to see this prayer and to realize that this prayer is not just a nice prayer. It's not just a cool prayer. It's not just a great prayer to start and end a worship service with. This is a prayer of a follower of Jesus. This is a prayer of a follower. Only a follower can say to God, "I don't want what I want. I want what you want, God." And that's how Jesus teaches us to pray. Now, if you're like me, you might be wondering or thinking, "My heart isn't always there. My heart isn't always there. I don't want to do what God wants all the time. I want to do what I want." Even if I know that Jesus, I follow you, I want everything that you have for me, we struggle. We struggle in our hearts with giving over our desires to take up God's desires, God's plans for our life instead. But Jesus is speaking to people who are just like us. These are not perfect people. These are people who are just along for the ride of Jesus' miracles, most of them. They are here and they are just interested. But Jesus is praying to imperfect people just like us. And the people who latch onto this are not perfect people, but they are people who are willing to learn from him. People who have decided to follow him. People who have decided to let God change them step by step. Not people who are perfect. So when our hearts struggle with this surrender, this is a prayer that leads our hearts to change. This is a prayer that we can pray, that Jesus teaches us to pray, so that our hearts get aligned with the things that really matter to God, the things that please him. To pray this, "Your kingdom come, your will be done," we decide in that moment to let down our will and to take up God's will. "I want my will, Father, but I choose your will over mine. And I want your will to become mine." And that's the change that we need, and that's the prayer that Jesus gives us to pray so that we can help our hearts form after that. This is a prayer of someone who is not perfect but is willing to trade his heart or her heart for the heart that God wants. And that's a heart that trusts our Father's leading. And Jesus says, continue praying like this. After he talks about all the surrender, he says, pray like this. "Give us today our daily bread." The food we need. Not just bread. Water is implied. Okay, this is Jesus saying, give us today the stuff we need today to live. Having first set our hearts on what our Father wants instead of what we want, we still rely on him for what we recognize that we need. Now, a follower of Jesus doesn't just look to give up everything for God and to deny the needs that he has, but a follower of Jesus who knows the heart of his Father knows he can trust God not just for direction, but also to provide for what we need. Our Father who loves us wants to be our provider. And so this prayer, which is a follower's prayer, looks to God to lead us, but it also looks to God to provide for us what we need. And there's no, oh yeah, give me food, and I really like that house over there and that boat and that thing. Jesus leaves those out of this prayer, and I'm not really sure why. God, Jesus says in other instances, we are to look to God for all of our requests. But here in this prayer, Jesus is shaping our hearts. And this is to be our hearts when we pray for a boat, for example. I really don't care for a boat, but I'm sure I care for many other things. My wife thinks we'll never own a house, so I'd pray for a house. But this is the heart that Jesus is seeking to shape in us. And it is a heart that says, God, I need from you what I need. I want from you what I want. But I want from you what you want more than what I want. And so even when we're praying for things that are extravagant, things that are extra, Jesus is saying here, first, look to God for what you need. You can trust God. You can ask God for things that you want. But look to God for what you need. And first, what is important in our hearts for us to have a change, a transformed heart that really sees God, that really has life, that's a heart that says, I lay down what I want for what you want. So that's why Jesus here is focusing on the food that we need daily. Not because it's wrong to ask for other things, but he's focusing on the heart that we need to have as we pray. God is our provider, but he's not our servant. And that's the heart that we need to have at all times. And then Jesus says to continue like this. He says, and this comes from a heart that trusts God also in part as a provider, looking to God for what we need, but also a heart that trusts God to lead us. And this is what he says. He says, forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. So here Jesus is referring to sins, referring to things that we have done wrong, that others have done wrong. And they are debts because in doing something wrong, we are stealing something from another. And especially our Father, our God, our Creator, everything that we do is against his will, his plan for us, is stealing from him what rightly belongs to us, and that is that belongs to him and that he wants for us, and that is life. That is true, good life. He says, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. There's a sense of responsibility here. And this part of the prayer is very important, and this might be a real struggle, a real challenge for us. But this isn't just, again, this isn't just the cry, the prayer of someone who wants something. This is someone who follows. Someone who says, God, I want you, I trust you, so I am following in you. And as I follow, I trust you to provide me with the forgiveness that I need from you. As I follow you in forgiving my enemies. And in case we confused what Jesus is meaning here and right off what he's saying here, he clarifies after the prayer in the next couple verses in 14 and 15. He says, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Now, this is a really challenging thing. Does this confuse, challenge you? It's like, does this feel like a second condition of salvation almost? You know, believe in Jesus and forgive your enemies to be saved? As I mentioned last week, and we need to stay focused on when we when we hear the words of Jesus, we need to measure them against the character and the overall message of Jesus. When we hear words of Jesus that might throw us off a little bit, we need to measure them and think about them in line with the rest of what Jesus says and not take them out of context of who's saying this. And Jesus is not saying that we need to earn God's forgiveness from him. God's great offer to us, and this is through the whole Bible and especially clarified in the New Testament, is that he offers a restored, a new life from him and with him that is entirely undeserved. And that is salvation. That's what we need. It's what every human heart hungers for. And this is not something we earn. This is something that God gives, something he has paid the bill for. And part of this gift that he offers us for free is this forgiveness that we absolutely need from God to have peace with God. In Isaiah 53, this is how that gift is described in poetry hundreds of years before Jesus came to earth. As Isaiah 53, it says, "But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities," or our sin. "The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him," on Jesus, "the iniquity," the sin, "of us all." Now this poetry is a picture of Jesus on the cross. The Son of God taking the hit, the punishment that our debt had laid up against him. And this debt was laid up through our doing wrong to other people, doing wrong to ourselves, ignoring or pushing away God's will for us, worshiping things and people other than him, looking to something else to live for, to obey. That's the kind of debt that we've each laid up for ourselves, and we cannot pay that ourselves. We cannot pay for that ourselves, and that is a terrible problem. That's a terrible problem. But God offers an incredible solution, and the solution that we need to that problem, and that is the perfect Father. He sends his perfect Son to pay the penalty for our imperfections, our wrongdoings. Broken people, messed up people, confused and rebellious people with their debt now totally paid for. That's the gift of salvation that we come to this church to celebrate. That's the gift of salvation that has changed lives, that have led to people like Jethro, people like the Fells, to want to surrender their lives to their Father's will, to follow. New life. A fresh start, new birth. That's the way this is described. That is the way this is experienced. A birth into the family of God with no debt hanging over us, nothing left to pay in order to settle our account with God, nothing between us and our Father. And how do we receive this gift? If Jesus has already died for the world, you know, why doesn't everyone experience this new life? Why doesn't everyone experience this forgiveness? Why doesn't everyone experience this peace with God if Jesus has already died for the world? But in order for us to have this gift, we have to trust him to give it. We have to believe in him. Through trusting him, not just so that he gives us stuff, but trusting him, trusting God, trusting Jesus, we are set free. That is how we receive this gift. That's the relationship being described in this whole prayer. A relationship of trust. Not just a relationship of, God, I want from you everything that I need, like forgiveness, like a boat. This is a relationship of someone who trusts God, not just for what they want, but also to lead them. And as we see here, God does not listen to the prayers of bystanders, of those who do not trust him in the same way that he listens to the prayers of those who follow him. And this is an incredible thing we need to take to heart. God does not listen to the prayers of people who do not follow him in the same way that he listens to the prayers of people who follow him. God is the Father of all. Okay, he's all of our God. He's the God of everyone, even of those who do not acknowledge him as their God. He is their God. He is our God. But God listens to our prayers differently. He listens to the prayers of those who look to him to trust and to follow him in a different way than he listens to the prayers of those who do not trust, do not follow him. It's not that God doesn't hear all prayers. God hears prayers of people who, for most parts of their life, have totally ignored him. He listens to people's prayers who have absolutely ignored him and gone the other way with the rest of their life. He listens to the prayers of people who are in prison for terrible, terrible things. And he listens to all of our prayers. But the way that God responds to our prayers is different depending on whether or not we follow him. When we follow and trust God, we can absolutely be sure that our Father hears those prayers and he recognizes those prayers. And he answers those prayers with his blessing. When he's asked, "Father, forgive me," he says, "Yes, child, I forgive you. Yes, child, you can be so sure that I forgive you. I've heard your prayers. You can absolutely trust me to forgive you, just like you are trusting me when you forgive others." Those are the prayers that our Father hears. The prayers of boys and girls and men and women who trust him, not just looking to him to fill their wants, but who trust him to provide and to direct them, to tell them what to do, to lead them in the plans that he has for them, the things that pleases him. Your kingdom come, your will be done, is the heart here. Prayers that come from the heart that seeks God, that trusts him. And yes, God hears those prayers. Sometimes I wonder when I have asked God to forgive me of things that I felt terribly guilty for. Or I'm like, you know, I'm a 17th offender kind of thing, you know? I've done over and over again. And I feel like, okay, God, do you need me to, you know, to get on my knees and pray this time? Do you need me to get on my face and pray this time? Like, do I need to pray for 3 minutes longer so that you'll forgive me? And I've wondered, God, do you hear that prayer? But God clarifies that he absolutely hears our prayers. It's not that we need to pray lengthy prayers. It's not that we need to say the right words. He hears and he knows and he sees our hearts behind our prayers. But the only thing that's necessary is that we trust him, not just for what we need, but trust him also to lead us. If we're not trusting Jesus to lead us, and thus we're living for something other than him, we're looking to God maybe to give us what we want, the things that we need, but then on the other side, we're trusting in our own will to be everything that we need, everything that we want in life, to satisfy us, to be what this world needs. We, just like the pagans that Jesus talked about earlier, are living counter to the God who made and gives and sustains life. Living counter to the God who made and gives and sustains life. And if we're living in the opposite direction of that God, that's death. That's death. To not trust him means that we have everything that we want, but we are separating ourselves from the life, the forgiveness, the comfort of knowing and being protected by our Father for all time. And we've stepped away from him. And the sins that Jesus paid for on the cross our sins are not counted there, because we've held on to them, because we have not trusted him to take those things. And he doesn't hear and answer our prayers in the same way that he hears and answers the prayers of his followers. He does not forgive us like we ask. When we trust in Jesus, we entrust both our death and our life to him. He takes our death and our sin to the grave, but we also trust him with our life, and he leads us into good life, into new life, into life that can never be taken away. But when we don't trust Jesus, we hold on to everything we have brought to the table. We hold on to everything we have brought to the table. And that includes our sin, that includes our will, that includes our life. But that is not enough. That's a life that lacks the provision and direction from our Father, who is the author of life. And when we hold on to those things, that's what hell is. That's what hell is. Hell is the place where we're most separated from our Father who gives life. Hell is the place that is most separated from our Father who is the author of life. And so to not trust the author of life for our life, we're saying no to that. We're saying no to that. And that's why hell is described as a place of punishment, a place of pain, and a place of unforgiveness, because God is not there. And when Jesus teaches us to pray, he's telling us to pray in a way that will train our hearts and lives not just to trust God for what we need and want, but also to direct us, to trust our Father. Because when we trust him for provision and direction, that is where life is. When we trust God in our lives for both provision and direction, that's where he is. That's where life is. That is where we forgive and we are also forgiven. That is where our Father has his will and kingdom. That is where he has full reign in our lives. That is where we have everything we need. Everything we need. And life eternal. When Jesus talks about this need to forgive, this is not a second condition to being saved, but he's talking about the only condition, and that is a heart that is willing to trust him. A heart that is willing to trust him to take away our guilt and sin, and to take that away, and a heart that is willing to trust him to lead us. And if we trust him, believe in him, we are forgiven and we are saved. And we also trust him to lead us to forgive others, because he tells us to forgive others. Now, I think it's important that we talk just briefly, what does it mean to forgive another person of our debts? Okay, obviously, this is very important to Jesus. Obviously, for him, to forgive our enemies is indication of whether or not we are really trusting him. So this really matters. And we could preach an entire sermon series on this. This is really important. There's a lot to think here when we think about forgiveness. But let's just talk about this briefly. What does it mean to forgive others their debts? What is Jesus asking us to do when we trust him? To forgive someone their debts means to stop trying to get even. It means to stop trying to get even. It means to stop expecting them to make it all right. To stop expecting them to pay for it enough until they somehow pay us back for the things that they've done. That's the forgiveness that God wants to give us. You owe me nothing. And he expects us to give that out to others, because we are his children, following his way of life, not our own. Now, forgiveness is not a natural thing to do. It's not a natural thing to do. It's only really needed when there's a real wrong that needs to be forgiven. And when there's a real wrong, there's real hurt, there's real anger that cries out for justice. And that is where Jesus is talking about when he tells us to forgive. And because it's real hurt, forgiveness does not mean, one, pretending that it doesn't hurt or isn't wrong, or two, pretending that justice does not matter. Because there's real hurt, it doesn't mean we need to pretend either of those things. The hurt is real. The injustice is real. God, more than us, more than anyone, hates the hurt and injustice that people have done against us. But Jesus, in this prayer, gives us the right focus. We are to offer to others the deep need that we so desperately need ourselves. Forgiveness where it is not deserved or earned. And so all together in this prayer, Jesus puts these things together so we understand we are not just forgiving and we are not just forgiven, but together it is forgive us our debts that we do not deserve to be forgiven of, as we forgive the debts of others, the sins of others that they do not deserve to be forgiven of. Father, we absolutely rely on your forgiveness, the forgiveness you bought for us with your blood. We need to be forgiven by you. And the people around us have also done wrong against you and against me, and there's nothing they could ever do to make this wrong right, to pay for it themselves. They are unable to make this wrong right. And so for both of us, Lord, release us, free us from our debt, free me, and free the people who have wronged me, because we both are weak and incapable of paying our debts. And we need a forgiveness that we both do not deserve. And we trust you to provide that. That's what it looks like to follow and trust Jesus, to be heard in prayer when we receive Jesus' forgiveness for our sins and also forgive others. Now, again, there's a lot that we could say about forgiveness, but I want to say just a couple points here. And that is, one, if you are holding on to things that other people have done against you, don't let that fall to the side or go out of your mind and not deal with it. Okay, so Jesus sees this as really crucial, and we can trust him for two things. We can trust him to absolutely forgive us when we ask, and we can trust him to be leading us in the right direction when he says forgive others their sins. We can trust him for both of those things. He is a trustworthy God, and we can lean on him, and he will not let us down. He is not leading us astray to say, forgive the person who has hurt you the most. We can trust him. And so don't let that leave your mind. If that is something that you are struggling with, or if that is something that you ever struggle with, don't let that leave your mind. Deal with that. Take action. But here are some things that I think might be helpful for us. A couple resources. One, Jesus clarifies this a little bit to his disciples because they're really struggling with this as well. And in Matthew 18, 21 to 35, read that for yourself. Pray through that. Ask God for help with that, because Jesus clarifies what does it mean to be forgiven and to forgive other people. A second thing, good resource, an article by John Piper called As We Forgive Our Debtors. Now, I'll probably put these things on our LEMC Facebook page through the week, as we normally post anyways, so that you can find those things if you don't have the time to write them down this very second. But this is an awesome, awesome article that explains what is forgiveness, what does it mean to forgive someone, but what does it not mean to forgive someone, including things like it doesn't mean to pretend that it didn't hurt, it doesn't mean to pretend that there shouldn't be any consequences for those sins. This clarifies some of those things for us. Third, Jonah Mann. Right here. Jonah Mann. Jonah wrote an awesome article, awesome paper, called Beyond Good and Evil, Loving and Forgiving Our Enemies. And we're going to make that available to you soon. We'll print off a bunch of copies and make them available at the Welcome Center, and I'll keep you updated on that. But this is a really just helpful, thoughtful article that Jonah wrote. There's just a sort of a compilation of thoughts, biblical, and also looking at real just life stuff. And he puts those things all together, and I found it really helpful in terms of understanding, you know, why could Jesus even ask us to forgive our enemies? And I just found it really helpful, and I think that you also could find it really helpful. So, again, this is something that you can go to think through, to pray through, to ask God to help you through these things. And just to clarify, this is not a sales pitch for that article. They're not being sold. Jonah is not making money off them yet. Awesome. Thank you. But it was just awesome. And he just wrote it because it was on his mind, on his heart, and it was really good. But more than anything, more than any other resource we can do about this, this is a matter of us and God, our hearts, and God knowing our hearts. And so talk to God about this. Talk to God about how you're trusting him. Talk to God about how he could forgive you. Talk to God about how you can forgive others, because he is there. He listens. He's present. So this is how Jesus teaches us to pray. As a follower, one who trusts not just for provision, but for direction as well. But let's just finish up just this last line in the prayer, and that is, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Followers of Jesus are not followers in their own strength. Jesus does not expect us to be able to do, to be able to trust him and live as his follower in our own strength. Jesus here is talking to weak people just like us, people who struggle, people whose hearts are often all over the place. That's who Jesus is talking to. And so in this prayer, he says, we are to rely on God for help. We need to be good at it, good at asking for help, not just for help to do things that we want, but God, the help to do the things that you want, to not be tempted to do something else, to be delivered from doing evil, from being led by evil thoughts. To be led by God into places like forgiveness, into places like having a heart that desires his will above our own, that seeks his honor more than our honor, we can't do that with our own power. And so we have to ask God for help. And he will hear those prayers for help, to trust him, because this is a follower's prayer. We don't ask for help to follow him if we're not following him. And we can be sure, absolutely certain, Jesus is teaching us here, God hears the prayers of his followers. He hears the prayers of people who trust him, not just to have what we want, but trust him because we want to follow him and do his will. So we can be absolutely sure that he will hear and help us when we need his help. Let's pray to finish. Father, I just pray for the hearts of everyone in this room. God, you know our hearts. Father, and you have good things stored up for our hearts, good plans, good life. And Jesus, I pray that you would show us how to trust you. Because you've promised that it's in trusting you that we have all of that life. God, those good plans, those good things, that good life comes from your hand, comes from trusting you the way that Jethro is trusting you, the way that the Fells are trusting you to lead us and also to provide everything we need to be our good, loving, awesome Father. God, I just pray that you would help us, you would speak to our hearts, Teach us, Lord, where to go from here. And God, I pray that you would assure every heart in this room that you will help us to forgive others. You will help us to do what you've called us to do. Because you're with us and you hear the prayers of hearts who seek you. You promise us, and we trust you for that. Amen. After the service today, please join for the corn roast. Stick around, enjoy some corn, enjoy some just time with other people. And just thank you so much for being here today. Also, sorry, celebrate and congratulate and just shower with blessing Scott and Kate Bott as well, okay, for their marriage today.